Hey, sports fans, Coach Nick here, and welcome to B-Ball Breakdown, our Game 6 halftime show between the Pacers and the Heat. A pretty interesting game so far, and also kind of ugly, if I have to say so myself. My initial impressions so far are that the Pacers are squandering quite a lot of opportunities here to have a big lead. And so it's kind of astonishing to me that they're down at this point because of the way they played. And we'll go through some of the box scores and look at what's going on here. We also have some video clips to go through as well to show you what's happening and sort of mini breakdowns. But right now, I said this before all series long, the Pacers have done them a disservice by having DJ Augustine. If they could have just picked up anybody else in the offseason or during the season to get rid of him, they would probably have a lot less issues now. When he went in that second quarter or the end of the first quarter, literally the Heat scored on almost, I think, every possession that he was in. And he was getting in the way on defense. He wasn't picking up the man. He wasn't aggressive. And on offense, he doesn't make the right kind of passes, and he loses the ball. So it's a real nightmare. At least with Sam Young, when he comes in, he can actually play LeBron James defensively a little bit. It's a little kind of quiet secret out there that he's been pretty effective guarding him. LeBron hasn't been able to back him down all the way in the post. He seems much more willing to take a turnaround or a long two. And that's big because, remember, if you can keep LeBron James out of the paint, you're in as good a shape as you're going to be against the best player in the world. So a couple other things. Dwayne Wade, this is as bad as I've seen Dwayne Wade, I think, in the playoffs, really. I mean, he's had some clunkers with his bad knee in the past, but there's no question right now that he just looks terrible. And I think it could very well be his knee. And, you know, that doesn't give him any kind of explosion. But then he's still like that turnover he threw in the open court when he tried to make a pass up court late in the second quarter, that's not your knee. That's just a bad decision. That's just a bad play. And so really kind of frustrating to see him play so poorly. And I'm sure the Miami Heat fans are really having trouble understanding what's going on. Now, you throw in Chris Bosh, 1-for-6, it's just as bad. He had a right-handed drive into the lane that was just literally flipped it up. It was so ineffective and bad. I don't know what his problem is either. And so they can't get those two guys going, and they're still up by one. So they have a lot of cause for optimism here because you know that one of those two is going to get on track in the first half. Having George Hill back and actually playing decently has given them a boost on the Indiana side. And Paul George has been doing very well as well. And so is Hibbert. So they've been doing what they're supposed to be doing, but they've missed, I would say, at least 5 layups. And we'll go through a couple of those dunk attempts because, you know, if you try and dunk the ball and miss it, that's one of the most selfish plays you can do in a game because when you go up and dunk, it's got to be something you know you're going to make. You miss it, the team almost always comes right back down and scores. Certainly Norris Cole proved that today after those 2 missed dunks. Certainly the David West dunk was not a dunk. That's not a kind of play you can make, and that's not his kind of play normally anyway. It's just kind of a throwing it up there and hope something good happens. So really problematic. Well, let's get to some of our screen shares because I want to do something new today, which is bring in some video content. It might not play perfectly smoothly, but you'll get the idea because it's almost going to be like it's slow motion. So let's move on. Let's go to our first screen capture, which was let's see if I can find it here. Let's go to, oh, they're not labeled. Terrific. Sorry. Let's just grab some. We'll see how these go. Let's see here. The first one appears to be this. So what we have here is, let me make sure this is what we're having. Okay. Yes. So let's see what we have. This is early in the first quarter, and let me turn off the sound. Excuse me. Okay. So this is the Heat offense. We've been talking about the Heat offense being very stagnant with their 5 out, and like one guy tends to just sort of run around screening. And you can see here, they actually put in a little bit of weak side movement. This is basically 5 out. You can see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 along the perimeter. And there's not going to be a lot of cutting, but at least after the initial pass, you'll see Mario Chalmers come and screen down for Dwayne Wade in the weak side, occupying the weak side defense. Without that movement, it made the defense for the Pacers a lot more effective because they could load up on the strong side. So you can see what happens here. Dwayne Wade gets a double weak side screen with Chris Bosh as well. That's good movement coming around. So what happens here is LeBron opts to swing it to Bosh popping out, and then this goes right back into a screen and roll of five out. This is not great spacing here with Haslam in the weak side corner, almost at the three-point line, and you have Dwayne Wade at the slot. So we continue here, and they get a little bit they're able to easily stop penetration here with Chalmers on LeBron's man, Paul George, okay? So the other reason why they said there's nowhere to go in the lane is you got two guys on defense here, one of whom couldn't care less if Haslam catches the ball. I know he was making those shots in Game 5, but as we've seen in this game, he's not making them. Regression to the mean. So this leaves another pick and roll on the left side with Chalmers. I'm sure the Pacers are more than happy to let Chalmers run the ball, keep him on the baseline. And here's Haslam on the right side this time. Remember last game on the left side he was making all those shots? This time on the right side, he shoots it and burps up a tough shot with a shot clock winding down, and it's ugly. I might have even hit the backboard first. Let me see. I'm much more used to seeing him hit the backboard on his shots because I don't think that shot is very good that he takes. And so there you go. Very affected by the Indiana Pacers defense, but also that offense isn't terrific for the Heat. So let's move on to our next screen share, which will be let's see if I can do this. Okay. The next one is later on in the first. We have the Heat again on offense. And, crap, let me go here. Sorry, excuse me. So, again, here's Horns. The first time they run Horns is earlier in the game, a lot earlier than normal, which is great to see because we all know that Horns is very effective for them. However, look what they did. Do you remember what we showed in our breakdown earlier today? The best part of Horns is when they have LeBron James at the high post here. He did all his damage on the left high post. Do they put him there? No. Not only do they not put him there, they go strong side to where he is, which is okay, but then Chalmers goes to the weak side to screen away for Wade, okay? These are the worst options they have. When you go with LeBron in the corner, at least screen for him and let him come around and put pressure on the defense. In Horns, if you go away from the guy, he's just going to stand there for the most part. It kind of marginalizes him on offense. So here comes LeBron. So they get to LeBron in the corner. It's a post-up for Wade out of all this. Okay, so let's go back and I'll show you how that works. So basically, there's a screen here. Wade would normally get a double down screen and curl around on top, but he wants to post up Stevenson, even though that didn't do anything last game. And so he comes along the baseline instead. Now they miss him here. They did have a chance, but it's Haslam. Haslam isn't the kind of passer that's going to make a great pass backdoor to Wade. So here comes the post-up. And again, LeBron can't do much anyway. Haslam is here. His man's in the way and isn't going to care about what Haslam does. And then here comes Dwayne Wade getting in his way there. So there's no room for Wade for LeBron to do anything on this set. They give it to Wade down low in the post. And now he tries to go to work with a sort of a isolation post-up in the lane. And gets nothing out of it. I mean, that is as bad as Dwayne Wade's going to look. No explosion, you know, just a bad-looking shot, and West just takes it away from him. So let's move on to our next thing. And let me know, guys, are you digging this? Is this cool stuff? Because I think this is a really worthwhile stuff. Certainly better than what you're going to see on TNT. Let's go on to our next screenshot, which is our we have here in the first, 7:42. Sorry. Okay, so here's the first thing we're going to look at for Indiana's offense. And what we're going to see here is what they've been doing a lot of now is, as well as Roy Hibbert coming up the screen for the ball, they'll do West coming up the screen for George Hill, which is good because they're picking on Dwayne Wade, who's not been able to guard Paul George anyway. And they're going to leave Hibbert on the weak side to try and get position. So let's see how this ends up playing out. Because what happens is once they do this, you'll see Haslam, his face is completely turned this way to the play, and he's stepped over. This has now got a beautiful position for Roy Hibbert down low if they swing it. But what they've also been doing a lot of is hitting David West in the pick and pop in the flat. And that's okay because here comes Haslam has to rotate over because Bosch heads high. And that means that little Mario Chalmers has to guard Greg Hibbert. But what they're having trouble with is, again, they throw that ball away. There's no reason that they can't make an easy pass to David West here. That should be, Dwayne Wade is diving by, not really in the way. Paul George has to be able to make a pass, one pass away easy to David West. And he just throws it right over David West's head, and it goes out of bounds. It's hard to believe that a professional team cannot make that play because you can see how open Roy Hibbert would be if he'd seal, if he was sealing him here. And if not, then they can have a swing pass here wide open for George Hill, or they can get something going on the weak side. So really frustrating if you're a Pacer fan to watch. Let's move on to our next screen share, shall we? Which is, we just keep rolling down the hits. Turn the sound off, and here we go. So later in the middle of the first quarter, tie game, and we're looking at the Heat offensive set. So here we go. Another, this is the post up for LeBron. Inexplicably, Bosh doesn't get the memo and throws it back up to the top. And I believe what we're going to see here is, yeah, they throw it right back to him. Okay, Haslam's like, no, dude, you got to go in the post to LeBron. And this is a little bit of a triangle action. If you can see here, LeBron in the low post and Chris Bosh on the wing and Mario Chalmers in the corner. Now, a normal triangle offensive set here would be Haslam down low on the low block here and Wade on top, okay? They need to have that weak side position filled down low to drag Hibbert a little bit farther out of the way, but instead they have it on top. That's okay. They feed LeBron finally. In fact, in the triangle, you have a cutter from the weak side. Chalmers goes early because there's just not enough space there to get LeBron the ball. So they clear out. And now you got a problem. Here's the problem. This kind of spacing right here, for the most part, with three guys here, allows David West to stand here in shadow, Hibbert to stand in the middle, and George Hill could guard three guys with one. Now, Stevenson is in danger of being called for illegal D, and he has 3 seconds to get above the free throw line. I think he just about pushes it before he gets back up there. You see it there. And they get what they want, which is a LeBron James face-up settle for a shot. Now, one of the reasons why he can do that or has to do that is because of the spacing over here. There's nowhere to drive to. It's a real easy Hibbert come over to pressure the ball. So the Heat need to do a lot more on the weak side with spacing and movement because they're making it real easy on the defense. Now, LeBron hits this shot, okay? And you should be, okay, Miami Heat fans are going to say, that's great, right? Well, he hits the shot, but that's exactly what they want. And if the Pacers are going to lose with LeBron making, you know, 18 footers with a hand in his face, then that's okay. They're going to lose doing that. But I wouldn't put money on it if I were the Heat. Okay, next up, we're going to look at our next play is, let's see here. Okay, we're looking at, here's the Pacers. So the Pacers are going to run something on offense here where they come down. And now Miami's up by two after that make. And here we go. So, okay, so again, you can see the same kind of play where they're going to run. They run Paul George through the lane, a little bit of motion here to keep the defense occupied. High screen and roll on the sideline going to the middle with David West. Okay, remember, their bread and butter usually is Roy Hibbert setting that screen. But remember, they want to try, if they would just swing and hit him, they would get a lot more action, but they're not doing that. But here they're going to get David West on the roll. So again, now look at here. This is a real problem because Haslam rotates over early, which is what they want to do, but then Bosch gets over there because it took enough time for them to throw the ball there. So they're double-teaming West basically in the mid-post area, and that definitely leaves no help for Hibbert down low with Mario Chalmers. It's just a terrible play. Now, again, all David West has to do is throw the ball up higher. Let's see here. Mario Chalmers is maybe 6'1". Hibbert is 7'3", I bet, okay? He's over a foot taller. It still boggles my mind that they cannot get professional basketball players for the Indiana Pacers to pass to one another in this kind of setting. They have to be able to get that pass. This is exactly why you're going to see the Spurs eviscerate the Heat defense, because this is what the Heat will do, and I can guarantee you Popovich is watching this, is going to run the same play over and over again, and that's going to be Splitter and Duncan, and they're going to make that pass every time. So really problematic because you can see how the Pacers are squandering a lot of scoring opportunities. Okay, next up. Serious, and we'll try and get to some questions too, so tweet us your questions. Okay, here we go. Our next one is later in the first. So the Heat come down. Here's our five out again. Again, Haslam is running by here. You got two guys too close to each other, and then James actually has a lot of extra space he shouldn't be having with Paul George. This is basically one pass away. So they come down, quick screen on with Bosch on top. And again, like I said, there's too much room from Paul George to LeBron James. Kind of hard to imagine since LeBron James is the best basketball player in the world. You can't really let him have that kind of room. Paul George, you let him get a drive like that. You can't let that happen if you're a defense on the Pacers. But LeBron James attacks nicely down the baseline. And then here's where the Heat are the best, when they get that kind of penetration and then LeBron can set his players up. I'd much rather see him do that and then kick out to Chalmers for these wide-open threes. When I start seeing Chalmers try and create things for his teammates, that's what I don't understand. And they put him in a situation way too often. And Chalmers gets the three. Now, let me just see here because they rotate over. Okay, so Hibbert comes over nicely here. Paul George has to rotate. I would like to see David West at least recognize that it's his rotation over. Okay, he's got to come over and get there and at least take away that. I know they're going to say, okay, let him have a three over a two from Bosch going to the basket, but I don't even think he recognizes that it's his rotation, and that's too good. You almost can't stop that. And it all came from Paul George giving so much room to his man, LeBron James, here. Okay? You fall asleep for a second, they're going to kill you. So good recognition by Dwayne Wade. That was one of his good plays for the half. Okay, next up, we have later in the first. Sorry, let me turn off the sound. All righty. And make sure you retweet this and tell all your friends that we're doing some serious breakdowns here. We got a lot more plays coming up. Okay, so here's an interesting little play they do. They added a little wrinkle I don't see much. And that's Dwayne Wade doing a curl inside with Chris Bosh on the side, okay? So this puts some pressure on the defense because David West is going to have to watch Dwayne Wade curling around, and that's going to open up a pass easy to the high post for Chris Bosh. And this is they're actually going to do a screen and roll here, which is a nice little action here because now they've occupied David West, and now they're going to get some opening here. Now, David West comes up way high, like they like to do on the sideline, especially for LeBron James. And that's going to force the ball out of his hands, which is fine. I know what I'm doing. Okay, here's what I wanted to say. So on the weak side here, there's no movement, right? You're going to watch these two guys, Cole and Haslam, just stand there the whole time. And when they do that, and when Wade goes through, he's just going to kind of run and not do much. Oh, my goodness, is the second half starting? All right, I'll finish this play, and we'll get back to the second half. When they do that, it allows the entire defense to shift over because they're not worried. These guys aren't moving, and they've seen that in the past where the weak side doesn't move. So they come over, and you can almost get a steal, and then there's Stevenson getting the steal anyway on that play. So there's just not enough movement on the weak side. So anyhow, we're going to get back to the second half. Thanks for joining us. And don't miss, we'll keep it right here. We'll put up a freeze frame, and then we'll keep up the updates for the game. Come right back here for the post-game show, where we're going to have lots more to go over. So thanks for joining us, and we'll see you in a little bit. All right, sports fans, welcome to our post-game show. We had a terrific halftime, and I apologize for going over. It went by so fast, I was having so much fun going through footage. But we have some other clips from the halftime we didn't get through, and then we have a couple other ones from the second half, and we can be able to kind of get right into it and show you some of the things that I see, you know, in real time. Very quickly, a couple of things to overview. LeBron James lost his mind out there on that call. Remember, the guy is allowed to go straight up and down. They've already did that a couple times earlier in the game. They didn't call a foul, so the precedent was set that they're going to let the defensive player jump straight up. And so, you know, LeBron did get hit a little bit. He's on the road. He has to know that that's going to be a possibility. So for him to, like, traipse on down the court's full sprint, you know, it's just not what superstars do. This is a guy who's supposed to keep his composure out there and lead his team, and it pretty much cost him the game, because I got to tell you, Indiana up to that point was having some serious sphincteritis. They had a very big lead that he came right down and were attacking with LeBron and really, you know, were about to take control of the game again. And once they got two free throws, now Fizdale got a technical foul. I don't think they showed what he did on the bench. He certainly seemed as shocked as anybody. And again, his reaction isn't the kind of thing you want to see from the bench. You want to have composure out there. You want to be able to show a united front of people who are in control and know what they're doing. And to see Fizdale ranting and raving as well after LeBron was going crazy, it just stirs everybody up, and it got the Pacers right back into the game and control of the game. Two free throws, they hit a shot, and that was it. This is what they're talking about now, is they're going to talk about David West. It's going to be his flu game, you know, like Michael Jordan's flu game. It wasn't quite like that, but certainly he did come to play and hit some really big shots. It was very impressive, even though his shooting percentage wasn't that high. So, you know, overall, you got to look at the fact that the Pacers scored 91 points. And other than the third quarter, they didn't even get as high as, you know, they had 23 points in the fourth, 21 in the first, and 18 in the second. They had a little bit of an explosion of 29 in the third, okay? And that's, you know, okay. It's a good scoring third quarter, but the Heat's defense is fine. They're doing, you know, they're holding them to a reasonable amount of points. Now, they're letting them shoot 50%, which is too high, and these are very slow games. There's not a lot of pace to these games. So, you know, 74 shots for the Pacers, you know, is a slower paced game, and they had 21 turnovers. So you have to look at it from the Heat perspective. They're the number one seed, and they're forcing 21 turnovers in a slow game. They shouldn't, and they're giving up 91 points total. They really shouldn't be losing these games. And so I'm going to harp on again, it's their offense. And again, I've seen two or three different sets they put in tonight that I hadn't seen all series long. So we're back to that 2010 offense that Spoelstra was doing, where he would every day change it up and add new different things that, you know, the players don't have any confidence in, and they don't have any rhythm playing. You're going to play on the road in Game 6 of the Eastern Conference Finals, and you're going to put a whole new set in there? That's outrageous to me. Then you throw in the fact that he changed his rotations up completely, playing Mike Miller, who had barely gotten any time, 12 minutes, and Shane Battier gets 4.5 minutes. I don't think he played at all in the second half. And that's just a recipe for absolute and complete disaster. It sounds like panic to me. It sounds like they really don't know what works and what doesn't work. And so I really just don't understand what this is, what's going on here. It's what I tweet out called coaching criminality, and that's what I call it, because you can't just radically change your lineups in the middle of a Eastern Conference Finals. You got to go with what you have. You got to play the players in the minutes they're normally used to playing if you want them to excel the way they need to. So, let me just tweet this out and make sure everybody knows that we're still here. All right. So, anyhow, that's my big rant on what Spoelstra is doing. It's really just mind-boggling to me, and I feel like there's a certain sudden sense of panic here. Now, the reason why there's a problem here is that they are predicated on just overwhelming the other team with their talent, with Dwayne Wade, with Chris Bosh, with LeBron James. This is how these teams end up... you know, how the Heat win games. They don't rely on clever sets. They don't rely on execution as much in the offense. They simply rely on the fact that if they get the ball to LeBron and Dwayne Wade and Chris Bosh, they're going to simply do what they got to do to score. And it ain't going to work against a top defense. It doesn't work if you don't move the ball, swing it, get LeBron James in the high post where he's best at out of horns. These are the things that all of a sudden you realize – coaches who haven't had good teams have had to struggle with. I've coached plenty of teams that have been on the other side of this, have been the Indiana side. They lose the ball. They can't pass it to each other. They can barely get the ball up to the rim. But we play tough defense. We play our position, and we make it difficult on the other team, and you can play up. Meanwhile, the Heat, they don't have a system to rely on. They're just throwing stuff out there. I don't think I saw – they didn't run probably their best set. I don't think I saw it once where they would screen away for LeBron for the, to the free throw line, and he then they get a back screen with Dwayne Wade and Chris Bosh. And those are called plays that the coaching staff has to call, and they're not calling them out of timeouts. They're not calling them when they're bringing the ball up off a break. It's absolutely coaching criminality. They're not running LeBron to the post. And if LeBron is telling them, you know what, I don't want to do it, I don't like doing it, then they should just sit him down because he shouldn't be playing in the game and he's not willing to give them the best offensive opportunity they have, which is him posting up on the block. It's outrageous they don't have any other way of getting him down low. So that's a problem. And then also they don't run horns enough. They did it a little bit. They got some interesting things. They then changed and added the wrinkle where they're going to have Dwayne Wade post up. Now, this is Dwayne Wade's worst, I think, the worst playoff game I've seen him play. He's had some stinkers out there, especially in the last couple of years with his knee, but there's no question that what he is doing is awful out there, and you almost can't play him then. He played 33 minutes. You almost got to just limit him to 26 minutes and hope that maybe Battier will come in there and give you something more because what Wade did out there was awful. 3 for 11, two turnovers. He did get two steals, and he hit a couple shots in there, but he just doesn't look right, and I'm willing to say it's his knee. Something is wrong with him, and they don't seem to recognize that. And Chris Bosh, we have evident. I'll show you a play why he's a terrible rebounder. He doesn't go for the ball. He lets the guys pin him underneath the basket. He's just not a rebounder, but he's got to be. And if he's going to do his part on this team, he's got to get better at that, and it's all heart. It has nothing to do with where he's playing. Should be on the floor. It's all hard. He needs to go after those balls. He ended up getting 4 rebounds. He should be getting 8 rebounds in his sleep. I'm not asking him to get 6 offensive rebounds. We're asking him to get a number of defensive rebounds when he's near the basket and he's not getting. So it's really awful. They're shooting 36% for the game. And I don't know. My mind is being boggled. Now, I did tweet out in the middle of the game that Paul George is slowly showing us why he's a top 10 player. Now, he's definitely loose with the ball, and he can make some really awful passes. But there are moments when, without even touching the ball, he is the most dominant player out there. Okay, he's taking away passes. He's knocking the ball away, getting steals, running the break, getting a pick and roll, and really causing some trouble for the Heat. Now, Dwayne Wade cannot guard him. We've seen this enough times now where he's able to score easily on Dwayne Wade. We've seen him now score easily in transition on LeBron James. And LeBron James has had some moments here on defense of getting scored on, I'm sure he's not used to. So suddenly you're in a position where a Game 7, anything can happen. Now remember, Miami's going to be at home. God knows they're going to throw Joey Crawford out there as one of the refs. It's going to be crazy. I would suspect that the Heat are going to have a big advantage in that area no matter what. So I would be surprised if the Pacers are able to pull it out. But then again, what I've been seeing on the offensive end by the Heat, if they do another one of these, and we'll chart every possession, and I'll show you how it breaks down. If they do another one of these kind of games, they're going to lose. They're going to lose, and it's going to be just like this. So, because by the way, the Pacers, again, didn't really go enough, in my mind, to the high pick and roll with Roy Hibbert. They didn't go enough to swinging it to Roy Hibbert on the weak side after running a pick and roll with David West high. There's a lot of things they're not doing they could do more of. They're the ones who are doing kind of just enough to get that lead and hold on to it. So I think that if the Pacers really take a look at this and really hammer it home, they're the ones who can be favored in Game 7. So let's go to our screen shares and start looking at some of these video stuff because I like that this new thing that we're doing, and hopefully you guys like it too. So let me go back to our earlier ones we missed early. So here we go. We have let's see here. This is in – okay, this is not the one we're watching. Nope. Oh, crap. Let me get to the one at 6 p.m. Here we go. This one. Okay. So here we are with 9:46 to go in the second quarter. Let me turn off the sound here, and let's get going here. So this will be a little stutter, but you should be able to follow. All right. So here we do. They have a down screen. This is one of their decent plays I like to run. A down screen for Ray Allen, but this is really misdirection. This is simply a screen for LeBron James by Ray Allen. And then normally what you're going to see is a flare screen for Ray popping out to the wing. A lot of times it's going to be a big man like Bosh. But they flip this, and North Cole, I don't think, is going to set that screen. So, but a lot of times what you see is everyone goes to LeBron, and that means that Ray Allen is wide open for the three. And this becomes a sideline screen and roll. They're going to contain this, and they're going to be able to rotate now. Sam Young, who's supposed to be guarding Ray Allen, can now watch Battier a little bit as he's going to pop up. And again, there's no sort of flashing and weak side concern for the defense. They can completely stare at the ball and see where it's going to help instead of having to be worried about the weak side. And so here, they do a nice job of containing, and this time they don't have to switch on this, and Paul George is able to stay on LeBron James. Okay? And now at this point, I don't even know. I look like let's go look at that, because I'm not even sure what the heck Battier is trying to do. Oh, yeah. This is their five-man out where they just throw it to the guy in screen form. This is sort of like high school offense, the kind of thing. You pass the ball and screen to him. They're right in position to guard this. This is just not clever at all. Anyhow, this becomes an isolation. The shot clock is now winding down. These guys are not going to move. All three guys can slide over and get in the way now. And you can see, there goes Roy Hibbert. It comes over, and the shot clock winds down on good defense, good hands. Okay, so it's a troubling offense, to say the least. This is what's going on here. They're not going to be able to do well if they continue to play this way. Let's look at our next thing that we have, which is a little bit later in the second quarter. We have, okay, Miami's down by four. Okay, and here we go. Let me turn off the sound. Excuse me. Okay. So here we have, okay, here's the play they love to run where they kick it to Cole on top, and then they do a sideline screen and roll and let him control the possession. Without LeBron James in there, I guess I could see why this is their second option and let these guys beat off of him. I'm just not so happy seeing Cole and Chalmers with this much creativity. They're better when they spot up, and then they can break their man off the dribble. So they get some penetration here. Nice closeout by Stevenson here. Remember, Joel Anthony is a complete non-factor. He hadn't been playing at all. All of a sudden, he appears because of Birdman's suspension, and now it's 4-on-5 on offense. They don't have to watch him really at all. Okay, good. And because of that, because they don't have to worry about him, whereas they'd have to be a little bit more concerned about Birdman, here comes Roy Hibbert. Very nice move, by the way. Everyone should learn this behind-the-back move going to the middle to the baseline here by Ray Allen. But real simple, Hibbert comes right over, blocks that shot. Beautiful. That's exactly what Hibbert should be doing. Looks like I kept more of this. Oh, yeah, this is okay. So this is awful. Great defense down here, but here comes Sam Young. You need to lay this ball in and make sure it goes in. You miss a dunk, it's the most selfish play you can make because you can't afford to miss that. And that's not a dunk attempt for him. That's a layup high off the glass, nice and easy. So, of course, whenever you miss a dunk, the other team always comes right back down and gets a shot. Usually it's a layup. Here, Norris Cole's going to come right back down, go away from the screen, pull up for an open jump shot because Hibbert's on position. They wanted to shoot that long too, but he nails it. Okay, so now we're going to come back down again, and here you'll see they run a zipper cut for Stevenson, and we're going to get the ball over to David West. So you know what's coming here, right? They swing the ball to David West. Now he is got the same kind of mind control that Sam Young had, and he's going to go to the basket. He is not a high flyer by any stretch of the imagination. Goes right to the basket, and he's going to try, literally, look where he jumps from. He's going to try to dunk the ball from outside the restricted area off of 1 foot with a guy on him. This is like what Dr. J would do, not what David West can do, and he misses the ball. You watch that, and if I get a better angle, you'll see he's not even close to the rim. He just throws it at it. It's just a real terrible play, and of course now you miss a dunk. Here comes Cole. They can't stop him, and he rolls the ball in for a layup. This is really big, can you hear me shaking my head kind of stuff, because you cannot do this kind of stuff in the playoffs. You have to know your limitations. You have to know you cannot waste opportunities against the Heat defense like that, and that's all that was. So let's move on to our next thing. And by the way, are you liking this stuff? Because I think this is a great thing. Give me a tweet or give me a message in the comments. Let me know what you think about our new video breakdowns. So here we have the next one, which is let's see here. Later in the third quarter. Okay, Indiana's up by six. They had a mini run to start the second half. Oh, yeah, so this is out of a timeout. Indiana went on a run because, remember, the Heat were up by one to start the third quarter. And you need a basket. You need to run a good shot. So what are they going to run? Are they going to flash LeBron James to the free throw line like we showed how good that works? Are they going to put them in the post? Are they going to run horns? No. They run five out with a little bit of a screen here for Dwayne Wade in the corner by Chalmers, okay? Which is not the worst thing. But this becomes, again, a screen and roll with LeBron James. And I believe they score on this. Oh, no, I'm sorry. They don't score on that. It becomes a play for Mario Chalmers. It's unconscionable that they don't call a play that will facilitate LeBron James. Let him dominate the ball, control the offense, and get a good shot for somebody on that team. Instead, it's called the give-it-up screen form, and now you're relying on Chalmers to make a good decision under pressure, and he airballs it. This is coaching criminality. You can't call a play like that out of a timeout. Wow, I'm hot today, guys. This is stuff I can't take. Let's see here. The next play we have is later in the third, not too much later. 7-point lead for, they're shooting free throws, 7-point lead, and I believe this is going to be, let me see here. Yeah. You want to know why Chris Bosh is a bad rebounder? Let's watch him right here, okay, under the basket. David West won't even really push much on him. Watch what he does. He steps forward underneath the basket, doesn't even go for it. I know it's a bit of a long rebound, but he didn't ever push back. It shouldn't happen, folks. There's the rebound. They come around and set up a little bit of an offense. Let me see what happens here. All right, let's see. Okay, so again, let's watch this. Remember, the high screen and roll is working for Indiana because the Heat offense loves to get out of position when they do this. They'll try and trap the ball. The hedger comes up way too high. So here we have David West setting a screen going to the left in the middle on Dwayne Wade for Paul George. Okay, and let's look at the spacing here. So you have Lance Stephenson here with LeBron on him, which is the normal way they like to guard it in earlier part of the game. And you have a guy on the wing here. Spacing is not so great here because now Chalmers can get in the way. So let's see what happens. David West doesn't roll. He sort of like stands there and pops. But look what they have. Wade isn't disciplined, leaves his feet to jump. And on this, I think so does Chris Bosh. So Chris Bosh ends up jumping, and he's above the ball here. It's not good position here. And now you got a problem because you have Hibbert, who's huge with a smaller Haslam on him, and all he has to do is attack the rim a little bit, looking for Hibbert, and there is a nice little dump off, and you can't stop that. There is no rim protection, and there's no rim protection anyway for the Heat. So a real big problem for the Heat when they have those two guys in there doing the high low. Let's move on to our next one. So we have here. A little bit later in the third, not much, and we have the score is, okay, so Indiana's continued to increase that lead. Remember we talked about one run can take the game here. That's all it takes. And their one run in the third quarter basically wins the game for them. So here we go, Indiana on offense. Let me just see what this is. I like this little wrinkle with it where they'll have two high posts. It's a little bit of a horn set, and they go high post to high post, which is interesting. Now, we've seen in the past where they'd have a guy posting like Paul George, and they'd have Hibbert feed Paul George, but instead they want to do a pin down for George on the weak side, and they get some good movement. Oh, yes. And all this movement is terrific because look what it does. It pulls everybody out, and it pulls Joel Anthony out, who wants to be a pressure player, and look, very simple. Joel Anthony should never be that high on Roy Hibbert. He's not a threat to really score out there. And the one thing he can probably do is blow by him. A beautiful spin move right to the basket for the dunk. You can't stop that. I mean, that's just gorgeous stuff. And the Pacers are killing them. And look, and Danny Granger is killing me a little bit with his wardrobe. Let's now move on to our next screen, which is, let's see here. All right, we have, toward the end of the third quarter, the Heat come out again. Now they're down by 14. You absolutely, positively need a great shot. They've shot 2-for-13 from the field. They need to call something that's going to get them a good shot. So what do they call? LeBron brings the ball up as a point guard. They do a pin down. Okay, so this is the pin down for Ray Allen, and then Ray Allen's going to screen the ball, okay? This has gotten a lot of great stuff for them because Ray Allen would pick and pop, get an open three because everyone's concerned about LeBron. Very ineffectual screen. LeBron didn't wait, so now they're way too far to the sideline instead of waiting for that screen, and they don't have to switch. So they still have Paul George on LeBron, and now the shot clock is working against them. Screen again. Now, this is like when in doubt when you're running offense with the Heat, just screen the ball. If you don't know what to do, if you don't know where to go, they just screen the ball. So now it gets LeBron open a little bit. They come over with one pass away, which isn't supposed to happen. Stevens is supposed to stunt and jab at him and then get right back, but he comes over too far, and it gets Wade into the basket. But Stevenson knows that they have Hibbert here, and this is Anthony. Hibbert doesn't have to worry about Anthony one bit. So he comes over to defend Wade, and look at that. Wade just misses the layup. Okay? I mean, let's watch that again, because, you know, that's the kind of thing that Wade would have dunked on him in the past. And if he doesn't finish that, and this is what the Pacers are doing, they're forcing the Heat into tough shots at the rim because their offense isn't clever enough, isn't getting enough good positional stuff and not enough movement and not enough cutting. It's basic basketball, which is why I don't like to watch it, and they don't do it. All right, next. This could have cost the Pacers the game right here, because LeBron James is shooting a free throw with 2.6 seconds left, okay, and he cuts the lead, and they bring David West in, right? So he's a little bit fresh. He just had a rest, but he's not quite in tune with the game. So they're going to get greedy here. After he makes the second free throw, you're going to watch. All they have to do is get the ball in. There's no sense with a 15-point lead to do anything stupid. And watch what he does. He fires the ball after staring it down, who he's going to throw it to. It's not even close, though, where this ball goes. It, like, short hops the guy. Because, by the way, if it was any higher, maybe it goes out of bounds. I could stop it. But instead, it goes right to LeBron, the one guy, right to the basket. And then he fouls him. Look at the clock. He had a shot at just not touching him. Maybe he doesn't even get the ball off, okay? But he just kind of tackles him there. It was terrible. And he gets two more free throws, and that's a real dangerous playing with fire kind of move here. So you can see that both teams aren't playing that great. The Pacers had 21 turnovers, and man, some of those were bad. Some of those are the kind of head-scratching, are these really professional players kind of turnovers. That's not going to change. We have to accept that. These guys don't have that skill level to handle it. And by the way, not all of it is even the defense of the Heat. I'm telling you right now, it's just simple, like, ball handling, picking the ball up, jump stop, nice good bounce passes, accurate passing without pressure on you. That's what they're lacking right now. It's really troubling. And so here, what's our next? We have a few more of these. Our next one I grabbed is, okay, so 9 minutes, 14 seconds to go in the fourth quarter. We turn off the sound. We have a 10-point lead by Indiana, and this is now going to get rocky here. The Heat are kind of trying to go on a run here. And so you'll see, they don't have Hibbert in. They're getting him a rest because they played him extra minutes in the first half. So you got Mahimi in there. And instead of running a high screen and roll with him and getting into what they usually do well, they bring it over, and now the shot clock's running against him. And they took way too long to get into the set. So they swing it to Paul George with Ray Allen on him. Now, this is good space for him to work on, because he knows Ray Allen doesn't guard him very well. Instead, they opt to go with the curl by George Hill. Oh, okay, good. And they swing it. So they end up getting a very nice possession out of this, ultimately. Now, the thing with this is let's find out why David West was so open on that weak side screen. Now, remember, the guy setting the weak side screen is always the most dangerous, because everyone's going to watch George Hill on the curl. So you got to keep your eye on the roll, on the guy screening. So it's not a screen and roll. It's a weak side screen. Joel Anthony has to come over because Cole got picked off well. And this is the key here. George Hill is aggressively attacking the paint. Now, you see here, they're going to have to rotate over. LeBron has to rotate over, no choice. Joel Anthony should be dropping down to watch LeBron's man. Okay, let's see what happens here. So he does that, okay. But look, this is really bad defense by LeBron. He closes out and lets him go middle, the one thing you don't want to let a player do. When a guy goes middle, he becomes an all-star. Now, watch David West, a nice little floating lefty hook, knowing that there isn't anybody there to defend the rim. Not even Joel Anthony is very good at doing that, and he's getting screened by Mahimi anyway. So, a little lefty layup puts it right in. That was really poor defense by LeBron, and we've seen a little bit of that recently where he's not been able to contain Paul George in the open court and even in the half court, and there's another one. So these are all, you know, you cannot let him get those kind of passes and those kind of shots if you're trying to come back. So now we're later on. They made a run. They cut it to six. And we have here. Okay, so now Indiana is reeling, right? They need a basket. It's 8 minutes to go. Plenty of time for the Heat to make that run and get back in the game. So now they do a Paul George screen and roll, which is not bad. It's actually a double ball screen. Brings the entire Heat defense up high. Now look, Miller has to already start rotating up here. And then you have Mahimi with LeBron James. So, actually, LeBron is guarding Stevenson, but because he's rotated over, this is interesting. It's a really interesting matchup here because, LeBron is guarding Mahimi. So, On the screen and roll, they get it to the pick and pop. Now they're going to ISO a little bit on Ray Allen, which is a good play for Indiana because Paul George can score on him no problem. Backing him down. Now, yeah, this ended up being an awful possession. Now, part of the reason why it was awful is that nobody moved here. No cutters, no nothing. Look at the Heat defenders. They are staring a hole in this post-up because they're so concerned about Ray Allen. All Stevenson had to do was cut during that whole time before he started turning his head back when he got in the layup. Or same here. Look at LeBron. Let's go back. I don't think LeBron ever even turns to see or feel for Mahimi. Look, this whole time over here. This is a quick cut here, dunk. So they need to get better at that. They can exploit that a lot easier. And as a result, George Hill has to burp up a bad shot and misses, and they dodge a bullet. So next. All righty, we have 7:21 left in the fourth quarter, and we are in the end just nursing that six-point lead, desperate to try and get a basket here and save this game. So what do they call? Okay, they put a new wrinkle in last game with three guys across the free throw line, and the guy in the middle, normally Paul George, is going to flare out to one of the sides with a little screen, then that becomes a screen and roll. Well, this time they decided to invert it. I'm not exactly sure why, but they put George Hill in the Paul George role, and they have Lance Stevenson, who doesn't know what the heck is going on. You can see George Hill has to kind of point it out and say, get out of here, move down in the corner. So there's the flare screen. It's going to be for, to get them open, and then they do a nice little screen. Now, this gets a nice movement, a little action. It's a, kind of a European set to me. You don't see a lot in the NBA, and that becomes a pick and pop. Now, the Heat defense didn't have to rotate too much, so this wasn't so effective here in this setting. But they end up getting enough space here for David West that he hits the tough shot. And these were a couple tough shots he hit that were big for them. Because that's not a really efficient shot. A long two, there was no rebounding, but he hits it. So credit him for making a tough play. Then we go to, looks like our last clip of the night here that we could grab before it got too late before this post-game game started. So we have nursing a four-point lead. Key play here with 5:44 to go. And what are they going to run? Oh, sorry. I didn't mean to go backwards. So what are they going to run? This is their Roy Hibbert on the weak side in the triangle setting with David West in the high post, one of their bread-and-butter good plays. So here's what they're going to do. Now, LeBron James, they don't even make contact on that screen and roll. And so here's a bit of a wrinkle. Instead of setting the screen and roll, they're going to flash Hibbert high to the high post, okay? And it looks like Stevenson is going to cut through and, set a down screen. So this is interesting stuff. Good movement. Ray Allen, for whatever reason, decides to come over to gamble, which is not a good play because it left Paul George open. Okay. So they do a pin down here, or a pitch. Excuse me. It's a screen and roll. Joel Anthony, as he likes to do, really comes up high and gets stretched, leaving this whole thing open. Now, Mike Miller's already rotated. This is good for him knowing that Joel Anthony's going to do that. So he rotates over early, and that means Lance Stevenson's wide open, no one guarding him if he's going to cut, but he doesn't. And now we have Roy Hibbert, though, with Mike Miller on him, and that's when they double-team strong. Okay, not bad because Mike Miller can't handle this. Now, earlier before this, we had seen a double team and Hibbert dribbles the ball. Hibbert should not be dribbling the ball with a double team on him. It just shouldn't happen. He needs to be able to either face up, hold that ball strong, and pass, or that's the only thing he really should be doing. But he gets away with it by one dribble, gets some space. Now they swing it. Really simple. Now, why is Paul George so open here? Let's see how this works. Ray Allen is on him here, and when they double that ball, Ray Allen's still here. They have to rotate. So let's see here. We're in good position here. Ray Allen shouldn't have to go any lower. He's going to have to watch for Stevenson here and for Paul George. With the swing pass, he should have time to close out. So let's watch what he does. Okay, good. So Lance Stevenson did the right thing here. On that dribble out, Lance Stevenson slides in underneath the basket. And that's right. Ray Allen has to go down here to guard the layup. He has to give up a three to guard the layup. So guess whose turn it is to rotate? It's LeBron. LeBron should be rotating up and getting a hand up. Ray Allen comes over here to David West, and Mike Miller, who's doing the right thing, runs back down here to cover underneath the basket. That's how it should happen. Does it happen that way? No. LeBron James just stands there, watches. Ray Allen, is slow anyway getting out there, doesn't put a hand up, and they nail the three. Crucial play. Very crucial. Good. Nice to end on that. That was crucial what happened there. So there's some really interesting plays going on here. A lot to go over for the breakdown tomorrow for sure. So let's get to some, let's go to our screen share and just walk through the box scores really quickly as we like to do in our normal segment, which is, I believe it's right here. So end of the first, Miami 23, Indiana 21. They came out, a little bit ugly, both teams. And you see only three total turnovers for Miami, which isn't bad. For them, it's good. And three turnovers for Indiana. So they both were holding on to the ball okay. But Miami shot pretty poorly. LeBron did well to open up 4-for-7 with 10 points, but not much else. Mario Chalmers, 2-for-2, did well. And after that, so look at this, 6-for-9 from those two guys. And after that, 2-for-11. Okay, so the rest of the team is just letting them down. And again, it's because of their offense. They're not running the same sets from one game to the next. They're not calling the same stuff enough. There's no rhythm there. They're expecting the guys to create their own shots against one of the best defenses against that. It's not working. Meanwhile, you had some nice contributions, just like we had in Game 5. Paul George and Roy Hibbert led the way. Each had 9 points. Remember, they scored the first 23 points of Game 5, I believe. So here you go. Same kind of thing. 18 of their 21 points from the two players, and they're shooting 45%. So this is all pretty good stuff here. And rebounding, 15 rebounds to 9. So they're already kind of destroying them on the defense, on the rebounding edge. No offensive boards for the Miami and 4 for the Indiana. So it's a real problem that the Heat can't seem to combat. At halftime, again, another ugly quarter, you can't argue with the Heat defense. They're shutting Indiana down for the most part. 21-18 is nothing to slouch at. But then again, Miami is only scoring 17 points with 3 of the best offensive players in the league. It's unconscionable. So what's happening here? LeBron continues to do damage, although he went below 50%. But again, 5 rebounds, 3 assists. He's doing very nicely across the board here and being, tough. Not much else. Okay, 9 points for Norris Cole off the bench. A nice little boost, only giving him a +1, though. And look, LeBron ended up being -8 playing most of that first half. Now, here's something really interesting. LeBron is a -8 in 19 minutes, and Chris Bosh is a +6 in almost the same amount of minutes. It almost doesn't make any sense. But you can see that. And even Dwayne Wade, in the midst of one of his worst games I've seen him play, is a +8. So, obviously the plus-minus doesn't always work. It doesn't always make sense. But there's something to that there. I suspect it's probably because they ended up having a couple extra minutes, just these two, when LeBron sat down and they went on a little bit of a run, which they did. So, it's a bit of an anomaly because clearly LeBron James is the one, bright light for the Heat right now. And then on the Indiana Pacers side, again, Hibbert and George continued 13 points apiece. 26 of the 39 points, and 40%. That's very modest here, very modest. 7 turnovers is a little bit high, not terrible, but a little bit high for them. And you can see 27 rebounds compared to the Heat had 23. So, again, they're getting beat in the boards, not as badly in the second quarter. Wait, how did that happen? Sorry. This must be the third. I didn't get my third quarter. Okay. Well, this is the third. Okay. Third quarter. At the end of the third quarter, Miami only had 55 points, 34% shooting. Awful. This is really terrible stuff. And again, I'm going to attribute it to the way they're playing their offense. They were missing a lot of shots at the rim. They might not have gotten a couple calls. Okay. But it doesn't really make up for 34%. It might have made it 40%. They might have gotten about 6 more points. But still, way too low for a team that has this much ability on the offensive end. LeBron, 20 points, 5 rebounds, 5 assists. He's doing his normal kind of work. Nothing crazy. And Dwayne Wade got to 10 points, but it was ugly the way he was missing shots. And, let's look at Haslam, 0-for-2, okay? I told you this earlier in the day on Twitter that he was going to regress to the mean and go back to what he was doing. He wasn't going to go another 8-for-9 this game. And here we have 22 from Paul George. Again, displaying the fact that Ray Allen can't guard him and Dwayne Wade can't guard him, and then LeBron had some trouble at time as well. Now, David West didn't do so much. Look, 1-for-8 through three quarters. 10 rebounds is good, but he was not playing well on the offensive end. And Roy Hibbert, that's really healthy to see 10-for-17 through three quarters. They should be getting that many shots. He should be shooting 20, 22 shots a game. And that's what he's doing here. And here's George Hill bouncing back nicely through three with 12 points. Remember, if he had just had 12, 14 points in the game 5, it's a completely different game. And then here we end, 23-22, only outscored them by one. That third quarter ended up being absolutely huge, and that's what won them the game. And we finished with 36% shooting. He ain't going to get it done. Even against the Pacers, you're not going to get it done. You know, LeBron, 29-6-7-6. Good, not outrageously out of control. 10 for 21 is deep. You know, all these things are good numbers, but he got that technical foul and ranting and raving. Everyone got a little crazy. Dwayne Wade, you know, not good. 3 for 11, got to the free throw line only twice. And Chris Bosh, just disappearing. Just disappearing like a Bosh. It's really embarrassing. 4 rebounds, 5 points in 31 minutes. They had 33 total rebounds, whereas 53 total rebounds for the Pacers. That's just a blowout, okay? 21 turnovers there with quite a few of those in the second half. And they're not going to clean that up. It's going to happen all game. So they're never going to fix that in this series or the rest of this year. They're going to have to get rid of DJ Augustine. I think he's just killing them whenever they play. They need to upgrade that, and it shouldn't be hard. And they need to get Danny Granger back. And, you know, then they'll have something. Maybe if they can get Hansbrough to get a little bit better on offense, they'll have something. So, just incredible stuff. And you know what? I'm excited about this. I love Game 7s. They're always the most interesting, exciting things. We had a sweep in the Western Conference, so we deserve some more games, don't we? This is going to be great. So I'm looking really forward to getting into that and diving into that, the Game 7, which is going to be on Monday, I think. We'll check it out. So, shall we move to the questions? A lot of stuff going on. This is a crazy, hectic halftime post game, but it was great to have you guys in here. Let's go to our Twitter questions and see how many we have there, and see how many we can get to. Now, let's tweet this out. We'll do a quick shout out if you give us a retweet. Let me just type us in answering your questions now. All right. So here we go. Let me make this a little bit bigger and resize the window for you. All right, can you read that? Let's see. Looks like you can read that now. All right, so now we have, wow. Let me go back. I didn't know I had so many. Let's see here. Let me go back to the beginning of our show here. Is there any good reason not to play Battier? He sets the best picks. Huge on D, hits the three. Absolutely not. You're right. Good question, Fernando. For sure, that I don't understand why you would just completely change your rotation. Even if you think the matchups don't work, they'd have no problem going small. They go small all the time. I don't understand. It's a real problem, and I'd love to hear the answer in the post-game press conference why Spoelstra decided to do that. It seems LeBron is surrounded by the same talent in Miami as he was in Cleveland. Oh, my God, forget about it. You had Mo Williams on that team. This is ridiculous. Anybody on that team is better than Mo. LeBron was way too passive, passing the ball too much. That's why he'll never be like MJ. Yeah, I mean, I think down the stretch, I feel like it's a thing about their offense. I really, really do. I feel like they need to have more sets that give LeBron the option of being aggressive and set people up. Right now, to do a isolation on top against the defense of the Pacers is not a winning proposition for him. Second unit of Heat seems to have more offensive chemistry. There was no chemistry out there either way, so I can't tell you that anybody had more or less. Do you think Miller should play more minutes? He looked pretty good. He had a couple threes, right? But I don't know. The guy hasn't played at all. I don't see how you can expect him to do well by throwing him out there and then have the rest of the team go along, and he's also not so great on defense, so I don't think he should be playing too much more. Thanks, Javi, for the retweet. Top 5 coaches in the NBA. You got to go Pop. You got to go I'll put Vogel in there, I believe. You got to go Tibbs. You got to go who else is up there? I wrote this out the other day. Pop, Tibbs, Vogel, gosh. Let me think about it. I know I'm forgetting 2 more really good coaches. It seems to me that Bosh has fallen in love with his okay at best 3-ball. Yeah, well, I'm not so sure. I think Bosh, the Heat need to call sets that get Bosh into positions, and they need him to post up. They have to go back to Bosh posting up on the right block, and we'll know now if Spoelstra or somebody in the Heat organization watches our breakdowns, because if he starts doing it in Game 7, because he is devastating down there. Get him down that low block. Let him get a couple fouls on Hibbert, if it's Hibbert guarding him, or West. I'm telling you, that's a very viable option for him. Can I name the best defenders in each position? Jeez. Well, you got like Butler and Paul George and Tony Allen all in the same position. They're all like the best defenders on the wing anyway. I think Norris Cole is up there. He's a really good on-ball defender for point guards. Who else? I think, but Chris Paul is also, you know, probably just as good, if not better. And then center-wise, it's tough. I think maybe Noah is the best defensively, although Hibbert is doing nicely. And let's see here. You know, or Duncan, I guess, for power forwards. So, Coach, now looking like Miami only has big one rather than big three. Can they close out? Yeah, they absolutely can close out the series. Indiana doesn't have the experience. They're going to be on the road. Who knows what the refs are going to be like. It's going to be interesting, and I still say the Miami Heat have to be favored. Do you think Haslam will hit again like he did in the last two games? No, I think he'll regress to the mean and continue to shoot like he would normally do, which is, you know, below 50%. He probably flopped during warm-ups and got tech for it or something, okay? The referees during this whole playoffs have been horrible. You know, there have been a lot more horrible games, or there have been a lot more horrible games than I can remember than normal. Certainly they've been better overall, but yeah, there have been some serious clunkers out there. How big was Greg Hibbert's contribution tonight? I wish that was really him. Great. It was huge. Greg Hibbert finished 24 points, 11 rebounds, and oh my God, I saw what you did there. Did you do that for me? No way. This is let me know, Greg Hibbert. I can't believe you got me on that. If you did that because I call him that, that is very cool. That is a tribute, I suppose. Wow, Coach, can you comment on the Wizards' outlook for the future? What you think they should do? I think they're going to be pretty good. They played pretty good, pretty well with a healthy John Wall down the stretch. So I anticipate them being good. This you know, continue to work and get better in the offseason. You'll see that they'll threaten for the playoffs. Let's see here. Thank you, Alexion, June, and Eric for retweeting us, getting the show live. Coach, do I think Grant Hill will be in the Hall of Fame? That's a tough one. He was so on track. He was so good for about four or five years in Detroit, and then he got hurt. So I don't know if his body of work is really long enough. I really feel like he probably just didn't quite play enough. But when he was healthy, yeah, he was a Hall of Famer, surefire. So it's a real question of whether or not they're going to think he has a big enough body of work. What was your take on LeBron's reaction? I think I talked about it earlier, but certainly it was Bush League stuff. You cannot be carrying on like a little schoolgirl like that, and I think he should be embarrassed. And you know what? They had a shot of him in Game 5 doing the same thing, crying on the floor to the ref. It's just not very becoming of a young man. Would you agree that Spoelstra never sounds confident when he speaks to his team? You know, I see what you're saying a little bit. I think he's kind of calm, and it comes off as a little bit non-confident. But, you know, I think he's got a good rhythm. I think he kind of knows how to talk to him. I don't know. It's not striking me as being, you know, unconfident. Do I think the Pacers or Miami can match up with the Spurs with the way they currently play? I think that the Spurs, honestly, will carve up the Heat defense. Now, we see the numbers of Indiana's been putting up on the offensive rating. It's been pretty scary, actually, just how dominating they've been. You know, at one point it was 111 offensive rating, which is like, you know, would lead the league, I think, if that was for the whole season. So you can only imagine what's going to happen when you replace Augustine with Gary Neal, and you replace, you know, George Hill with Tony Parker, and you replace David West with, you know, Tim Duncan. And I mean, I think it's going – honestly, you know, you didn't hear it from me, but I think the Spurs can win like in five, I swear to God. But I feel like it's going to be a great series either way. It's got to be, but I think that the Spurs can go on some of those runs and just kill them. And there's going to be times they do it. I swear to God, you heard it from me here first. The Spurs are going to have those moments of 4 or 5 minutes of just gorgeous basketball, slicing them up, and it's going to be a pleasure to watch just good basketball. Let's go back to our Twitter questions. Great stuff so far. So, may retire along with fellow Dookie. Actually, it's cold shooting inability to defend West. What was this he's responding? Mark Heiser? I see. In response to Battier. Yeah, right. Battier might have retired with with what's-his-face we just talked about. Cold shooting, I guess so. But so guess what? Ray Allen has got his cold shooting, and he's shooting, you know, he played 21 minutes. No Joe Crawford in Game 7, please. Oh, you got to have it. You got to get Joey Crawford in there. Hell, throw the other Crawford, too, for good measure. That should be exciting. I feel like they never ref together, Joey and Dan. All right, thanks for the retweet, guys. Let's see. Dylan, I guess the real question that everyone wants to know is, can the Pacers win the Eastern Conference Finals? Yes, yes, and yes. Thank you, Gian, for the retweet. And Radicchio, let's see. Do you see any similarities between this Miami Heat team and the 2009 Cavs? Not one. No, not even at all. Not to a man. Maybe with the offense a little bit, by the way, because the offense was really bad for Cleveland as well. But certainly not by personnel. Thank you, Forever Purple and Gold, for the retweet. Could Mike Miller average 28 and 6 if he started today? He still seems to have it. No, not at all. Mike Miller, if he played 30 minutes a game, would probably end up getting about 16 and 4 and maybe 3 assists. That's, I think that's about all he would do. But then again, he might need to play more than get more Ray Allen's minutes and maybe some more Battier, because you're right, he is shooting a little bit better, but he doesn't give what Battier gives. So I would take Ray Allen down a notch and maybe give some more of his minutes to Mike Miller. A CP3 Westbrook trade. We've talked about that before. I don't think it's going to happen, but that would seriously give Oklahoma City a real shot at winning a title. Is Paul George better than Carmelo? Well, he is a million times better defensively, and he's got enough ability on offense that, yeah, you might give him a nod overall. You know, Carmelo is a lot better on offense, but you know what? George is getting better, and he's got his ceiling is continually getting higher and higher. So, I think when all is said and done, in the overall scheme, Paul George, if he does improve enough on offense, will be better than Carmelo ever was. I just told you my prediction on Pacers and Spurs. Pacers and Spurs. Wow. The Spurs would win in 5. Is Chris Bosh the softest player in the league? He's got to be up there. I can't think of anybody too much softer right now. Is this the Heat's last chance at winning a ring? Interesting. I would think it might be, because Wade might not ever make it back at this point. I don't know. Maybe he'll go to Germany and do some knee stuff. But right now, he's been breaking down every playoffs. Should they trade Bosch or let him go after his contract is over? Maybe try and get Howard or any quality center. Interesting question. I suspect they might look at that. They're probably going to look at Chris Bosch and see if they can get something for him. Maybe. But Steph wasn't on your list. You could talk to me to Steph or Harden flip-flopping either way. I missed part of that conversation. Do you think the Heat should fire Spoelstra and go after Sloan or Jeff Van Gundy? Wow. If the Heat lose to the Pacers, maybe. Maybe. But we can't really talk about that until that happens. But you know what? I'm going to tweet that out after we're done, and let's get that conversation going. What happens if they do lose the Pacers, of all people? I could see them, if they lost to somebody like Chicago with Derrick Rose, not being as big of a deal. But this Pacers team is not supposed to compete like this, and then they're certainly not supposed to win. How long does LeBron stay in Miami? I don't know. I couldn't imagine him leaving. So I don't think he was going to leave. I think they'll try and reload when Wade is done and, you know, get something for him, replace him and maybe get something for Bosch. But I don't know. I feel like LeBron isn't going to move again. Let's see here. My thoughts on Grant Hill. We kind of talked about him already. Thanks, Wayne, for the retweet. KG and Louie, thanks for the retweet. Do you think after Sam Young missed his dunk, West missed a ridiculous dunk attempt too, almost to show him up? No, I don't think he did it to show him up. It's his teammate. You know, I just think that maybe he saw – he saw Sam Young do it. He goes, "Well, maybe, oh, I see what you mean. Like, hey, this is how you do it, son." I don't know. You never know what goes on in their minds in the middle of a game. But it was such a bad thing. Do I think Birdman would have made a difference in tonight's game? He would have made a difference for sure. Joel Anthony sucks. Okay, he sucks, and he played 28 minutes. What did he go? One for? Wow, Joel Anthony got 5 attempts in the rim, no matter what, and he got 8 rebounds and 5 fouls. And he did get 3 blocks. So he did contribute a little bit, 8 rebounds and 3 blocks, but there's no question it's 4-on-5 with him, and they definitely suffered greatly from not having Birdman. What player from the past decade would you like to see make a return to the NBA? Oh, geez, I don't know. When they hang it up, I'm glad to see it so I can, you know, keep them in a positive light and not see these guys broken down. But maybe you mean if they weren't slow and they were playing like they did before? I don't know. I can't even think, because it's like Tim Duncan's the guy who's still playing. But who else is there? I have to think about that. Let's see here. What's the biggest difference between what Miami was doing last year in the playoffs and what they're doing this year? Well, posting up LeBron last year, they did a lot more of, and their defense wasn't getting lit up like this so much. I think teams have finally kind of centered on the fact that you can really hurt them with a pick and roll out high. And I mean, I think they kind of knew that, but this is a new level of killing them. And it also, Indiana particularly has a team that can hurt them with that. So like, just like you know, Memphis would be the Heat, I think. Arun, thanks for the retweet, my man Arun. Game 7 predictions. You know, I got to go with the Heat. You got to go with the home team. But man, I don't feel great about it. The mini video breakdowns are great, although the fidelity of the video could be improved. Yeah, it's simply a limitation of our internet, and that's just, you know, I have a fast internet, but it's just not going to play smooth. Should Bosh stay in the paint? I don't think he should stay in the paint, but he certainly should get five post ups. Oh my goodness gracious! You want a Spurs Heat series to go 7, but all your analysis say the San Antonio. Yeah, I know. I wanted to go 7. I wanted to go to a last second. I wanted to go to a last-second free throw to win it all, but you know, I'm telling you, like I said, I could see it going shorter than that. No one wants to attack Hibbert in the circle. Absolutely, he's especially when you have Joel Anthony in there, because Hibbert really doesn't have to watch what he's guarding. Let's see. How many people work for B-ball breakdown? Well, we have all the gnomes in New York for SB Nation that help us out, and we have Arun, who I just saw a retweet. So we have Joey, who helps me as well with a lot of the questions sometimes. So we got guys all over the place, you know, helping us out. Let's see here. So tell me, Greg Hibbert, did you do that? Because it's me. It has to be for me. Nobody else calls him Greg. That's hysterical. Let's see here. Do you think the offensive foul a good call on LeBron? Wait, was it an offensive or was it a no call? It was an offensive, but that. I mean, listen, the guy went straight up, so, you know, it shouldn't be a call on the defense. Eric Gordon for Danny Granger would benefit the pay. Oh, that, now that's interesting. That's a really interesting trade. I like Eric Gordon, believe it or not, and he's good when he's not injured. He's smaller than Danny Granger. That's why I like Danny, too, because he's got a good size. But that's an interesting trade. I don't know how the contracts work. They might work. Fascinating. I mean, Eric Gordon can go back home. Interesting. Can LeBron's defensive mishaps be partially attributed to the fact that he has to expend so much energy on offense? Yeah, I mean, certainly that has a lot to do with it, I suppose. How did Battier manage to play only 4 minutes? I don't know. I really don't understand. It's coaching criminality. Thanks, Mei Ling L, for the retweet. Oh, right. Yeah, right. Brothers ended up signaling a foul, but he didn't. He just looked like a kick. Why Wade so terrible? You know, you got to say it's his knee, and you know, his kneecap keeps sliding around out there, so I'm sure it kills him. Okay, I don't know what this is replied to, but okay, not a chance. How do the Pacers initiate their offense more efficiently with Augustine on the court at point guard? They don't. They just got to hope he can keep it together a little bit. He's not accurate with his passing. He's not a great ball handler. He doesn't shoot very well. So they just got to kind of hopefully he can keep it together, not get in the way too much, and give him like 3 minutes at a time. It's all they can rely on for him. And you watch, he won't play very much in Game 7. They're going to ride, unless there's foul trouble, they're going to ride George Hill as much as they can. George Hill is going to play 44 minutes. Let's see. Joel, thanks for the retweet. Greg, thanks for the retweet. Shiv, for the retweet. All right. Although Stevenson had a bad shooting night, how would you grade his overall performance? He made enough good plays. Yeah, he went 1-for-4. But he had 12 rebounds. I mean, that's just fabulous for him. And that was really key. That's all he needs to do is just make some plays. Doesn't have to be scoring plays. So is D-Wade just becoming senile here? You're just looking at a guy whose kneecap is in danger of popping out at any time. The best player from the bench to replace Bosh. Wade? Okay, good question. Thanks, Mei Ling. Let's see here. The best player, you know, well, first of all, the best player is Birdman when he's there, and he's just not in. So that's what they need him back in a hurry. And other than that, you got Battier. So those are the two guys that, you know, that can help them more. When do you think Vinny Del Negro will get his next coaching gig? I don't know. I was surprised he got hired so quickly after the Chicago debacle. And you never know. He's really good in the room interviewing. But I think he's going to have to sit this one out and wait a little bit longer. I would think that it's going to take a while for him to get another coaching gig, I would think. Do you think that Wade is finished? Right now, I would say yes, he is, unless some miracle happens where he gets healthy all of a sudden. But the guy's been like this for several seasons now. He's what, 33, I think, at this point? And I think it's been a lot of games on his knees. Speaking of Mo Williams, I still remember your no-mo breakdown. Yes, well, hey, you've been around a long time then. Let's see here. Thank you, Andrew, for the retweet. Coach Nick, do you think that Greg Popovich is looking down the Heat at this point? Well, I don't know if you mean by looking down, but does he think that he can beat them? I know he thinks he can beat them, and I think he knows he thinks he can beat them badly. Could you compare Yao Ming with Hibbert? Yao Ming is so much better than Roy Hibbert. It's outrageous. It's so much better. Passing, shooting, scoring, everything, the whole package. Spurs in five. I heard that first from B-Ball Source. That was supposed to be quiet. All right, let's get the last 11 things here, and then we'll wrap this up. Let's see here. Hibbert or Gasol, better polished postgame? Both Gasols have a more polished postgame than Hibbert. Thank you, Louis, for the retweet. Do you think that Dwight and CP3 are interested in the move to Atlanta? I think maybe. I know they talked about it like years ago, about doing it, but I don't know. I feel like CP3 is going to stay. You now have seen one of the officials for the Clippers coming out and insisting that CP3 had nothing to do with the coaching ouster because Chris Paul was angry that it came out that he was part of it. But I would suspect that Chris Paul ends up being back in with the Clippers. Let's see here. Thanks, Joel, again. Let's see. Am I written? No. Does the fact that Hibbert was in the restricted area matter on LeBron's charge? Yes. I think it does. Is that where he was on that? We'll have to look at it. We'll break it down. Do I think that Wade can adjust if they win the series and put up? Yes. If Wade comes with a 25-6-4, the Heat should win. Coach Nick, do you think that Greg Popovich is looking? Yeah, I already answered that. And okay, yes, I created this. Good. Well, we'll have to get you some more followers then. So let's wrap this up. A fantastic halftime show, fantastic postgame show. It's a nice long piece. You can watch it all. We'll download it and cut it up and get it up on our podcast ASAP. But again, thank you guys all for coming here. Fantastic postgame show. And stay tuned for the breakdown tomorrow. We'll have a really good one. And don't forget, at B-Ball Breakdown, we're not a channel, we're a conversation. You in?